Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Let somebody praise the Lord. I said, let somebody praise the Lord. Let somebody praise the Lord. Choir, I'm sure you know this song. Our generation shall praise.
My generation shall praise.
Let's sing it unto the Lord.
Our generation shall praise.
Our generation shall serve the Lord. Our generation will praise the name of the Lord. Everyone in my generation, we shall serve you, O Lord, because you are a good God. You are beautiful for all situations. Daddy, that is our confession unto you this morning. And we are asking our Lord everything that we require. So that our generation will serve you. That our generation will not become vagabonds. Our generation will not be one that will destroy the structure in the church of God. Father, please release it into our lives. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, our Father. We give you praise. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. In Jesus' name, we have prayed. You may please be seated. God bless you. Isaiah chapter 54 and verse 13. Isaiah chapter 54 and verse 13. And it says, and all thy children, how many? All thy children, one out of four. Or one, four, three out of four. All thy children shall be taught of the Lord. And great shall be the peace of thy children. Praise the Lord. Isaiah chapter 65 and verse 23. I'm going to read New Living Translation. Isaiah chapter 65 and verse 23. He said, they will not walk in vain. Amen. We shall not walk in vain. And our children will not be doomed to misfortune. For they are people blessed by the Lord. We are people blessed by the Lord. And our children too shall be blessed. And the last one that I want to read. Psalm 127. Psalm 127 verse 1. Says, except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. Except the Lord keep the city, the watchman waketh but in vain. In other words, the more you look, the less you see. The more that you think you can search out, the less that you may discover. That's what he's saying. And finally, Isaiah chapter 8 verse 18, giving us assurance. He says, behold, I and the children whom the Lord hath given me are for signs and for wonders in Israel. in Nigeria, all over the nations of the world, from the Lord of hosts, which dwelleth in Mount Zion. Praise the Lord. This morning, it is Talk Back, and we are going to talk about our children. And I'm going to invite our sister, Sister Ruth, to anchor the program. We are going to have a discussion like families this morning, because so many things that we see all over the nations of the world. Who are the people being used to throw bombs? Are they not our children? Who are the people that they are raping by the day? Are they not our children? Who are the people who are being used as terrorists? Are they not our children? We are praying this morning. In homes, many things are happening. People don't know what's going on right under their noses. But I pray this morning that the eyes of our understanding shall be enlightened in the name of Jesus. I want us to pray a prayer before I sit down. As you bow down your head, I want you to tell the Lord that, Father, let my labor over my children not be in vain. And if you are youth in the house, pray that the labor of your parents over your life shall not be in vain. Whatever that you have put your hands into, that will cut short your life, that will not allow you to fulfill the number of your days, and will not allow you to be who God had purposed you to be. Youth in the house, cry unto the Lord yourself, that today the Almighty God will look down unto you, and he will show you mercy in the name of Jesus. Cry unto the Lord. Tell the Lord that you don't want to build your family in vain, that the blessings attached, attendant to it, of a faithful servant of the Lord, that the Lord will release it unto you in the name of Jesus.
In Jesus' name we have prayed. Heavenly Father, we worship and exalt your holy name. We thank you for another opportunity you have given to us for this program. Daddy, may your name alone be praised. Only you alone know the heart of your children. You know what we are going through in our lives concerning our children. Therefore, Lord, you brought this topic unto us. Father, Lord, you've heard the cries of your children. Father, please bring help unto us today in the name of Jesus. Father, open our hearts, O Lord God, to receive in the name of Jesus. Everything we are going to discuss today, Lord, let it bring glory to your name and help unto us in the name of Jesus. We have prayed. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. We thank God for another talk back. Today we are looking at the topic, raising godly children in an ungodly world. Raising godly children in an ungodly world. Before we begin, I want us to look at a video clip that the audiovisual is going to show us.
What's up, guys? I'm Kobe Person. How easy is it for a pedophile to pick up an underage child using social media? Well, today we're going to find that out. I made a fake profile on Facebook posing as a 15-year-old boy. With the parents' permission, I friend requested three girls ages 14, 13, and 12 years old. I've been talking to these girls for the last 3 or 4 days, and today we're supposed to meet up. What we found in this video is shocking and something everyone should see. Be sure to watch until the end and use what we've learned in this video to better educate your friends and family. Hope you guys enjoyed the video. This first girl, her name is Michaela. She's 13 years old. We've been talking on Facebook for the last couple of days, and we're supposed to meet up at the park later when her parents leave the house.
I'm just waiting right now to get the text that her parents have left the house. So I just got a text. My parents just left. I can be at the park in 10 minutes. We're going to go see if she comes in 10 minutes. We're going to go right now, set up all the cameras, and just be waiting there for her.
So she said she's going to meet me at the park playground. So, this is the closest to her house, she said. So right now, I'm texting her. I just got here.
All right,
I'm just waiting. See what she says. She said, okay, I'll be there in 5 minutes.
She's coming, yeah. Michaela? From Facebook.
Michaela, are you crazy? Are you out of your mind? He could have been a rapist. He could have been a pedophile. How did you do this?
Yeah, you know that I could have been anyone. Like, you talked to me for the last 4 days. You've been talking to me on Facebook. You just, you know that, like, don't, you shouldn't talk to strangers, especially online. Like, I wasn't even the, do I look the same as my picture? Could be even worse than that.
You realize how scary this could have been? We have to talk.
This next girl, her name is Juliana. She's 12 years old, and we're supposed to meet up tonight when her father falls asleep.
So right now, I'm here with John, who's Juliana's father. We're going to see if she's actually going to come to the door or not. She said, this is the last text, LOL, I would have to wait till my dad falls asleep if you want to chill, because I can't have boys over. So she wants to chill tonight, supposedly. What do you think about that?
I hope she's going to open the door. God, I hope she doesn't open that door.
What's your address?
I pray she doesn't respond to this.
Well, I can't say the address, but she just literally just texted the address. Start driving to the address close by. My dad's going to drop me up. All right, so she just said, I think my dad fell asleep. You can come now. You want the light right here?
Yes.
Come outside. Come to the front door.
Online over text message and even had a phone conversation.
So right now we have the parents of Jenna. Jenna thinks her parents are going out tonight for date night. She thinks my brother is going to be driving, so she's going to get in the car, but she doesn't actually know that it's all just me. So I'm going to text her right now. Did your parents leave yet? Yeah, like 15 minutes ago. You think she's going to go through with this?
No way. Absolutely. I don't even believe it's up.
Okay.
I'm talking to her friends.
What's your address? Hey, is this your house?
Yeah.
Okay, let's go. All right. We are here. Come out. You don't think she's coming out?
She better not be coming out.
Nope. See the door open.
Yeah.
Yeah. I see someone. Understand now, so never ever do that again. This should teach you a lesson.
What's up, guys? I'm Kobe Person. How-
How easy is it for a pedophile to pick up a...
We didn't have our daughter.
You understand, you probably thought you were talking to a 15-year-old. You didn't even know what was happening, did you?
Praise the Lord.
Going with everything I was saying. You understand now. It's never...
Thank you. Thank you, church. I hope you followed the story. It's a true life story. The man posed as a 15-year-old on internet through Facebook and was able to engage with the knowledge of their parents, was able to engage these three little girls. One, the father, he said when the father is asleep, she's going to come out. And she actually came out. You saw the last one. The parents were in denial. They said they are not even sure that it's their daughter that is going to come out. Did you see that? Said they weren't sure that it was their daughter until the girl came in. And the mother said something. She said, I have taught you this. We've read newspaper articles concerning this. You know it. But the girl still came out. Praise the Lord. You know, we think that this is a foreign land. This happened in America, right? But it's happening here. Do you agree with me? You remember the story of the girl that traveled all the way from, I can't remember which state now, and where? Abuja. And she came to Lagos. She had been talking to this set of guys on internet, and she met them in the hotel, and she never came out alive. Praise the Lord. I want to read us three stories from our own children in the teenage church. Can we kindly listen? Our lives is much more beautiful when our parents are there. I was born into a beautiful family. My mom and dad were Christians, ministers as well. Our parents' guidance think they understand us, but they don't, not even a bit. My mom was always around, taught me morals, tried every possible best to provide all I needed. Each time we sit and decide to talk to her, she falls asleep, and it really annoys me. This really made me keep things to myself. I was molested sexually by her colleague's husband and son, and she never knew. She innocently sent me there to collect something, and each time I grumbled, she didn't understand and thinks I'm disobedient. So I go with fear of what the man might do. I wanted to tell her, but she sleeps off all the time. Finally, I couldn't take it. I told her about it. Imagine, she said, hope he didn't do anything. I said no. She said it's okay, and it ended. That was awful. It created a terrible scar in my life. It brought about so many mistakes I made, making me sexually active at a young age, having boyfriends, stole, even though I was punished. But you know, I wanted to tell her how I felt, but she was never around to listen, even though she was around physically. Some teens can't have a talk with their parents, where we tell them how we feel about the opposite sex, and so on. Some of our parents will shed tears when they find out all we've done. Parents think when we go to church, we magically become good. Most of us have parents, but we are even worse than those who don't. Parents, please create avenues where as female or male, we can walk up to our parents and tell them about our crush, the things we think, and our parents will understand and not yell or stand binding the devil. But they can put themselves in our shoes, understand our plight, and help us see what God desires of us in a loving way, and even take time to pray for us. Even as Christian teens, we have emotional struggles. Will our parents please put themselves in our shoes if they really pass through this stage? Please create an open relationship with your kids, especially before teenage age. Break down sex education. My relationship with my mother is getting better, but it can't correct mistakes of the past. Parents, will you please come to our levels as God helps you to help us? That's one story. The second story goes thus. My parents' actions and inactions that affected my life in ways that are negative. Till today, my mom and I do not really communicate. Our conversations basically run through school, chores, cooking, etc., but not physical issues. My mom is not watchful. She thinks she knows me to an extent, but she doesn't know me well. She never knew about the boyfriends I had, the guys that sexually abused me in my block, or even the one that stayed in our house. At one time, she saw me talking to a boy. She called me and said that with the way we were talking, people would think he's my boyfriend. She shouted at me to end the conversation. She never spoke about it. But he wasn't my boyfriend. I only had a crush on him. When I was little, I was abused in school by two guys. I told our house help, who in turn told my mom. My mom called me privately, sat me down on the bed, and calmly asked about what happened. And I told her everything. The next day, she went to school with me. My mom and dad hardly asked me how I am and wanting to really know. I grew up keeping things to myself. I hardly talked to my friends or mentor. Parents shouldn't allow young children sit on the laps of uncles or aunts or let anyone call them my wife or my husband. That's how the abuse usually starts. I don't see my parents as my friends. Parents should be their children's friend if they want to have a relationship with their children. One time, I lit a match, put it in my mouth. My mom shouted. She didn't explain why I shouldn't do so. I started lighting wrap paper, and then one time I smoked cigarette. Children and teens like to know the reason why we should not do certain things. The one time I asked my friend and if having a boyfriend was correct, she said no. I stopped having a boyfriend, even though I wasn't born again. The third story. I grew up in a loving family. Parents and siblings that loved me. But the environment I grew up in was not friendly to me. Growing up in a block of flats, I was exposed to sex, especially from elder neighbors, all in the guise of playing father and mother. Our parents felt we were safe as long as we were playing together, but they did not bother to find out what kind of play we were exposed to. All this led to fondling with each other and even masturbation. I had my first boyfriend at the age of 12. My parents nor my siblings did not know. I was very smart. I usually visited him after school, but I thank God for Jesus who came to my rescue before the devil could make a mincemeat out of my life. I advise our parents to be careful, to watch the kind of play their children are engaged in. I know all fingers are not equal and that we all don't have money to get big houses. But you can be watchful. You can be friends with your children. As teenagers, we only confide in our friends. If you want our confidence, befriend us. I speak especially to mothers. Do not be too busy for your children, especially your daughters. Life is not at all about money. The happiness of your children is very important. Please save us from having scars in our lives, which we look back each time with regret. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Our children, so much is happening today. Recently, a video went round, and when I saw this video, I was burdened in my heart. It was a birthday party. And I saw this group of children. They were dancing. And the form of their dancing, oh my God, was horrible. Horrible in the sense of horrible. I don't know if anyone has seen this video. They sent it on WhatsApp. And you know the amazing thing. If you look at the edge of that video, did you see parents sitting down? Did you see anyone that's? Did you see parents sitting down? They were sitting down on either side of these children. You know the form of a man and a woman, what they do. That was the dance step. Boy in front, girl at the back, or boy at the back, girl in front. Very obscene. This is a birthday party. And the mother and the father sitting down. And I'm sure they felt they were at the birthday party, right? It doesn't matter. It is the dance. It is the reigning dance. It is what they do now. As we were in the course of studying this and preparing for this, I had a story again of a boy, a son of pastors, living in a closed community. The neighbor was the one, the child goes to the neighbor's house to go and hang out with his friends. On one of those days, the boy left without the parents knowing. They went for a party. And on their way back, they had a fatal accident. And guess what? Who was encouraging these parties? The mother of the friend. She takes these children to parties. She takes the children to parties. Not just parties, parties with red lights. Taught them how to drink alcohol. And from alcohol, what goes on? Smoking and all sorts. So what are we exposing our children to? Who is at fault? Today's discussion is centered around this. Raising godly children in an ungodly world. The gadgets that we expose our children to. Is it that the Lord has so blessed us that we provide these things and there's no limit to it? Look at what Facebook has done. Through Facebook, little children, 8, 7, they're already in Facebook. They've changed their age and they're 12 years old. A man can pose as a young boy talking to a girl of 12 and the girl will think that the guy is 15 until she meets him. What do we do? Our children, they are our future. The Bible says we should train up the child in the way that he should go. Is that not what the Bible tells us? Please, we actually need help. I want contributions from the house. I want us to discuss this matter so that help may be rendered to families that children have gone astray, families that teenagers that are having these issues, parents that are having issues with their children, or you that got it right. Please, can you come out and come and teach us? Praise the Lord. We desire contributions from the house. It is called TalkBack. It is an interactive session. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Yes, come out. Thank you, sir. If you are a youth in the house, if you're a youth in the house, praise the Lord. We want you to come and share with us. Praise the Lord. If you can identify with what we showed on the screen or what I read, please. Feel free. Your life might just, it will change another life here and bring help to other families. Please, we have 3 minutes. 3 minutes each. Thank you, mommy.
Praise the Lord. I think my own contribution is on communications. We should be able to communicate well with our children. That this talks to our children. So that whatever happens in schools or we're among their peers, or among their friends, they should go to tell us at home. That play a major contribution. Then also, I will talk about love and taking care of the children. We should love our children. Those of us that have 2 or 3 or 4 children, we should show them equal love. Don't say because you have 3, you all love one, you don't love the other one. That also affects the children. then taking care of them. Most of us are too busy. Many times we have picked stick from children's food in schools. They will not take care of them. They will not prepare their lunch. They give everything to their households. We see chewing stick. We see a lot of things, foreign objects in children's foods. I think we should be able to take care of them, love them, and in doing this, and God Almighty will help us. In Jesus' name.
Thank you, ma'am. 2 minutes, please, ma'am.
Praise the Lord. I want to say that if you want to raise godly children, it's only godly parents that can raise godly children. Because most of the time, we bring the children to church, we come to church, we pretend as if we are Christians. But we are not living that Christian life. The forgiveness, the Christian humility, everything that adds up to be a Christian, we are not exhibiting it. And you know, when children want to behave, they do it outside what we are. So it is, at times, it is what we are that our children exhibit, the secret things that we are. So if we say we want to bring up godly children, we ourselves must begin by being godly. Thank you very much.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Good morning, parents, mommies and daddies. As a children teacher, I just want to point out some things to all parents. Please pardon me. Most of us parents, we actually taught these children to cover their head when they come to church. But we find that most parents, you don't do. And when we scold these children, they will come and tell you, you come back to us in that place, and you begin to shout at us. So many parents have come, leave my child, oh, that's the way I want my child to dress. And some of them will come with skimpy dresses, skimpy skirts, and, you know, strapless tops. And when we talk to these children, they will tell us, my mommy bought it for me. My daddy bought it for me when they travel. Please, we are begging. Dress them well, so that they will not be molested. Please. I will tell you an example that happens in our children's church. A girl of 6 went to the toilet, and a boy of 8 followed her to the toilet. And the boy ran to me, Mommy Yusuf, look at this boy. The boy is putting his wee wee thing on my body. I was shocked. I said, what happened? I called the two of them, and I scolded them. Though I called the parents of both of them, and I talked to them. But the boy, I was counseling this boy for over 6 weeks. I was talking to this boy, a small boy. I was counseling him, I was teaching, praying with him, and I prayed the boy has changed because I see follow him up. But what I want to say is that parents, please, prevent them from watching those bad things. And even what we do as adults, prevent them from seeing it. I'm sure this boy must have seen something overnight that he wanted to demonstrate or to practice. That was why he came the next day, and he did. And lastly, please, parents, you come to church, you pick them before the time. Between 9 and 10:30, we teach them Sunday school. We teach them the Bible. We have zeal. But most of the parents, you don't bring them until 10, 10:30. You will not come at 11. You are picking them again. And by the time you come, you've distracted the whole program. When two or three parents enter a class, the other children, they will not listen again. Please, we are appealing. Please, help us to help these children. Thank you.
Well, thank you all for listening. This is a very, very, very important aspect of our moral education. What I just want to say is in the area of love of children and freedom for children. There are parents who feel their children should be left. When they grow, they will understand. They will never understand. They will understand the wrong thing. Please, please, don't spare the rod and spoil your children. Freedom and love are not the same thing. You will love your children, but the best thing you can do to show you love them is to scold them, watch them when they do wrong things. Somebody can even blame your child. Say, no, don't worry, child. When she grows, she understands. That language is very, very bad. I will never help us. Please discipline your children when they are the age of discipline. And follow them up and watch what they do. God will help us in Jesus' name. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. I want to appeal to our parents that 2 years old, 3 years old, try to tell them the basic things of life, like smoking cigarette, what is wrong with it? Because when they see an elder, maybe an uncle, or the father is smoking cigarette, he will think this is sweet. I did it when I was in, I think I was 2 or 3 years old or so. I bought cigarette and I smoked it. Oh, this thing is not good. I threw it away. But up till now, I was living with my grandmother. She never knew that I've tasted cigarette. Look, I saw my uncles and some elders that I respect. They smoke cigarette. So please, we need to teach our children the dangers about things like smoking cigarette, alcohol, because I tell people alcohol kills. So tell these children, you look them as if they don't know anything. By the time they tell you things they know, or things they have done, you'll be surprised. I was outside of this country for some time, in one of these West African countries. I was dealing with the teenagers. Go to your teenagers, be their friends. They will tell you secrets. These guys, they were telling me things their mates were doing. And put confidence in them. They will tell you their secrets, and you can now encourage them and tell them the good things of life. But it's not pray godliness. You are getting it wrong. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. I think fathers should actually be in charge of the home.
You can sit down. Thank you.
What I discovered is that in order to love the children so much, some mothers give their children more money than they need. And so it makes them to, instead of listening to the morals, they spend more time what they call enjoying themselves. It's important to have early morning devotion. No matter how busy you are, the only time you can stay with these children and even your wife to interact and impart the kind of words God asks us to impart is early morning devotion. Because at that time, you can advise, you use the scriptures to correct some things that are not good enough. So the idea of fathers being so busy and mothers stay more with the children, and so they get more impartation. If the mother's impartation is so loving and so not encouraging, the father should be around to correct those words. So I think the father should actually be in charge of the home. Don't give them more money than they need and monitor them. The friends they keep. In fact, I encourage my girls, bring the boys to the home, so that we can see them instead of sneaking out and then teaching them to go in too, if ever you want to visit. So it's important to educate them early. If you think they know because of internet, they don't know because the elderly ones have lived their own life. They knew what happened when they were young, and they also know what is happening now. So don't think that your children have known so much and leave them. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Please, if you cannot come out, you can write and indicate. The ushers will come and collect from you. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. The issue this morning is quite an awesome and wonderful issue. I have experience in an international church. And as a leader of the church and the head pastor, I've seen situations where we have so many kids of different race, and this gathering where you meet children from different backgrounds, and we see the nature of the ways of life and how they relate to one another, you could easily identify the differences amongst them. The topic today shouldn't be based on what we see physically, but rather we should look at the spiritual prospect of what we see today. That has to do with how did you have your child? How did you have your child? We talk about Hannah in 1 Samuel. Hannah, before God blessed her with a child, committed the structure in the hands of God. And even before baby Samuel was born, the mother has laid a spiritual foundation for him. And that is what so many parents today lack. So many parents today, most especially the Christian parents. There are so many young men here today that are single. Some are married, no child yet. Before your child is born, what structure, what what foundation have you laid for that child? Is it a physical foundation or is it a spiritual foundation? And these are the things that we need to look at. We shouldn't be ignorant about the devices of Satan. And now we're looking at the physical, which has to do with the internet and what we see on the laptop and the system, but there's a trend coming up.
Can you round up, please?
That has to do with chips, and we have to be very careful that the technology is advancing. And it's high time that we teach our children the fear of God. The scripture says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Let our children have a very good foundation, spiritual foundation. So even while you are dead, the Spirit of God that dwells in that child will be teaching the child the right way to follow. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. To raise a Christian child, begin from the womb. When you are pregnant, you start to pray, touch your tummy, and talk to that baby. And the day you talk every day to that baby in your womb. And when you give birth to that baby, you still talk to the baby. It's unfortunate. One of my daughters lost a novel I bought, written by non-Nigerian women. Women, I want to tell you something. Your 6 months old daughter is wiser than you. Yes, I know it, and I read it from that book. But as I was giving people to read, I lost it. Please, let's train our baby from the womb. I have my ruler to beat my 6 months old baby when he behaves naughty.
Praise the Lord.
Yes. Hallelujah. So, please, and let us do one thing. I talked to them, the church I attend, Royal Parish at Igodo. If you go to mosque or this affair that teach children, you don't take biscuit to Ilekeu, but with civilization and money has turned things around. You give your children sweet, biscuit, this and that. In the church, they are not listening to the teacher. They are busy with their biscuit and sweet.
Thank you, Mommy.
Let's learn.
Thank you,
God,
Mommy.
Will help us.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. All said and done, the Bible said in Psalm 127, except the Lord builds, we build in vain. I grew up from a Christian home. We are many in my family. My father had many of us. We all came out of the same house, but we don't all have the same destiny. What it boils down to is that it is the Lord that can pick a child up. And it is your dedication and commitment that will make that child to follow you. We've heard all this Christian family, Christian this. It is the Lord himself that can hammer the matter onto the heart of the child. Some of my siblings don't even go to church today. We grew up in the church. 6 a.m. we have morning devotion. 9 p.m. we have evening devotion. They don't know about church. So it is only the Lord that can touch us and touch those children and make them walk in the fear of the Lord. One thing I tell my children is this. If they do anything, is that, will Jesus do this? They will say yes or no. We're coming this morning, they were quarreling in my neighborhood, and my daughter was saying, why are they quarreling? Don't they know today is Jesus' day? Because it is Jesus' day. But those people have church, we have church in front of my house. It is only the Lord that can help us in this generation we are in. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. My message to parents this morning is especially for the young parents. I'm a young mother, marriage 3 years. I want to say something to us who are very young. Most of us scold the children when it is ideal. And one of the partners would be supporting the child, and the other one will be saying, no, it's not supposed to be this way. What I want to say this morning is that as Christian parents, when I mean Christian parents, I mean parents that have good relationship with God. Because most of us come here every Sunday morning, but we do a lot of things that doesn't relate to God. I want to say to us, please, scold your children in unison.
When it is wrong, tell them it is wrong. I came in here this morning and I saw a child that has a haircut, this new Mohawk haircut. Either of the parents took the child to the salon and the child came back with that haircut. He is going to grow with it, seeing it as nothing. If it is the father that took him to the salon and came back with that haircut, the mom should be in a better position to say, sweetie, this is not correct for him. You have to lay the pattern for these children to trail. Because if you tell them that they can do it any way they want it, then they grow up to be very wild that we cannot control them. When you want to scold your child, please, in unison. Sometimes it is very difficult. You find out that you say yes, your husband will say no. But please, in prayer, tell God to teach you the right way to make these children grow. So that it won't be our fault. Praise the Lord.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I just want to add to everything everybody has said, because they've all said, they've dwelt on very salient points. But what I want to add is what the man that talked about, what the foundation will lay for our children, even right from the womb, we need to commit them to God. One, good. Now, when these children eventually come out, let's not stop there. A lot of us parents or mothers, to be specific, we dwell more on, Father, let this child come out safely. Let me deliver as a Hebrew woman and all that. We dwell more on that. And when these children come out, do you continue to pray for that child? Take out time every day. If it took you something to be the mother of that child, it should also take you something to raise that child spiritually. On daily basis, even if it is for 15 minutes, it's not too much. On your own. You can wake up earlier than, your devotion time, general family devotion time. Wake up earlier. Take time. Mention these children's name one after the other. Prophesy into their lives. Make it a habit. My brother, my sister, that foundation you have laid in those children, you will reap them. Later in life, they will give you rest because you have spent time to build that foundation prayerfully into them, and as you also teach them the word and discuss with them. The Lord bless us in Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord. There is another in the Bible that says, if foundation be destroyed, what can the righteous do? Foundation is very, very important. When you want to go into a relationship, what type of family do you enter? You marry because of wealth, or because of education, or because of discipline? That is number one. Number two, women, do we respect our husbands? Do you allow wealth or education or prosperity to look down your husband? If you don't respect your husband, how do you expect your children to obey you? We should remember our husbands are the crowns of our heads. Forget about education. Forget about your parents. Forget about money. When the husband is talking at home, allow the husband to talk. Let his ear be yes, let the no be no. Because these children are watching. Then when you are pregnant, what type of concussion do you take? Do you get time to breastfeed these children for 6 months? Then your school, the family altar. Are you autocratic parents? Do you involve them in the prayer meetings? Do you allow them to lead, or you still relegate them because they are small? Then the school, you visit their schools. You know their subject teachers. You don't know the class teachers. You know the year tutor. If you can give solutions, positive solutions, Mommy, to all these questions, that would be no problem.
Thank you, ma'am.
Praise the Lord.
Excuse me. Thank you. Continue, please.
Praise the Lord. By virtue of my orientation, I'm going to put it this way. When we need to look at raising children like building a house. To build a house, you need to lay a foundation. Nobody sees the foundation of a house. And by virtue of that foundation, it means before you even get into marriage, you need to pray about the children God is going to give you. Pray about their future. By that, you will have laid a spiritual foundation
for the children before they are even brought forth. Now, when the foundation is laid, you need to start building. Now, after you have laid the foundation and you have, let's say now you now have children, the blocks, it means husband and wife begin to raise the children. How do you put the blocks? You put block, you put mortar. That is part time. Right from even before the child is born, you talk to the child. Because by virtue of neurology, it says that once the brain is formed, the child can hear everything the parents are talking in the womb. Meaning that every discussion, every time you fight, every time parents abuse themselves, the child is hearing and being built up.
Then the
society has to be part of doing the finishing for the children.
Because in our society now,
nobody wants to teach the other person. You say, no, you don't touch my children. The society should be part of building up the children as well. Praise the Lord.
Thank you very much. Thank you. 1 minute, please. One minute.
Praise the Lord. The point I want to mention is total growth. Total. Sometimes we are one-sided, being spiritual. The medical aspect is very important. In my house, I tried to educate you. I got born again in secondary school because of lack of time. I won't go to some of the details. But the point I want to bring out is the medical aspect. When you educate your children about HIV, in my house, I make it very open, the medical aspect, because we work with NGOs. I've worked with several NGOs, and we bring many information homes. If you give a child a video clip of HIV, that child will hate both boyfriend and cousin friend. Boyfriend, sugar daddy, cousin, he will hate. This is HIV video. After watching it, even married men that sleep around, you go to Biapalo, you refuse to go home. After watching HIV video, you will be born again without a pastor. Praise
Thank you
Lord.
Very much.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Please, I just want to ask a question, and I need counseling as a youth. I grew up in a house that my father is very hostile to us, of which, as I speak, I don't like him. Not that I hate him or I want to harm him, but whenever I see him, I'm not always happy to see my father. So we grew up like that. Though we are all Christians, he's a Christian, my mom too. So all the old children, all of us grew up to the extent that if anyone travels out of the home, he doesn't want to come back. As I speak with you now, my eldest brother, I've not seen him since I was born. Although he's alive, I do call him on phone. But I've not seen him. I've not set my eyes on him. He doesn't want to come back home. The one that is senior to me, it was last year here I knew him. So I want to know, why should a father, because I love my mom, not that my mom don't beat me. He do beat me whenever I do something wrong, but she always corrects me. Most of the time, she advises me rather than beating. But my father, any slightest mistake, instead of him to correct, he will beat you. So that extent, we don't like him again. Whenever we see him coming, everywhere will be shivering. Everybody will be shivering.
Thank you.
If he travels, we don't want him to come back home. Yes, I want you to advise me.
Hold on. One minute, please.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Raising children, godly children in an ungodly way. We
godly
are in the
world.
Church.
Godly world.
Worldly world. Thank you. We are in the church. Everybody shout hallelujah, amen. Even some of the pastor children, we pastors are involved of what we are talking about. And so many of us here, we have children. There are some people here who have children, and their children have never in their life been dedicated to God. We celebrate birthday more than dedicating our children to God. It's a point. Any child that is not dedicated to God, and we hammer much on birthday, there is a comma on that child because his life is not of God. And we go back to internet connection. So many people, the clip we watch, 8 years old, 12 years old, who are on internet. Is 12 years or 8 years old boy or girl working that he can access net? We parents, we give our children money to buy Airtel, to buy net, to go into internet. And we are busy making money. We don't have access to our children. We don't talk to our children. We don't control what our children are doing. There are clips to internet that you can block. You give your phone to your daughter or your son. That child can only call. It can only receive, but they don't can enter internet. How many of us have been able to do that for our children? You can access the phone of your child. When you comes back home, you pick the phone and know how many SMS that child received a day. How many SMS that person sent out a day. And who talked to your sons or your daughter a day when you are not at home. How many of us do that? But we are busy. We are celebrating God. God will help us all. As parents, we should cultivate the habit of going closer to our children.
Thank you very much.
Praise the Lord. I'll be so brief. When I was four, I'm speaking this to my fellow youth. When I was four, something happened in my house. I was coming back from the school, and I saw my father. He was like, Malika Pola. He was speaking in tongues. And the following day, when I got to school, I started my own. Malika Pola. You know? No! The same way, I'll come back from school and I'll see my father smoking. I'll do the same. So now I want to speak to parents. Somebody said, it takes God. God will not come from heaven. No. You better train your child now. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. The lives that we live influence our children. We talk about Facebook. Us parents. How many hours do we spend on Facebook? Everything that happens in our lives, we are quick to post it. You are having wedding anniversary, Facebook. Pictures of party, Facebook. Discussion, Facebook. Everything, Facebook. Your child is talking to you, your phone is in your hand. You are pinging. A woman was pinging and lost her child in London. They were at the train station. Before she turned, she couldn't find the child again. The husband nearly killed her. She couldn't find it. Had to go to the lost and found. To God be the glory, she was able to find that child. She was pinging. Our phones are all our best friends. Our husband is right beside us and we are still pinging. What lives are we living as parents? The boy just said something. He said he saw his father praying in tongues and he began to pray in tongues. We see it. We watch Telemundo. Our children are right beside us watching Telemundo. And the child is saying, Mommy, what did happen? Ah, don't you see that woman? Yesterday's program, the woman and the man, they did this, they did that. We are busy watching it with them. What are we teaching our children? When the children leave home, how do they dress? Don't you see them dress? When they come back, do you check their bags? Those that even dress modestly to leave the home and hide clothes in their bags. My children come back from school and I search their bags. And I'm wondering, where did this come from? Do we take time, those in boarding houses, do we take time to find out, why come you have this item in your bag? Who owns it? Even a little child coming back from school and has a strange ruler in his or her bag. Do you question that strange ruler? Do you tell that child, that ruler, who has it? Where did it come from? Or do you even have the time? Are you busy sleeping? Or we are busy pursuing the things of the world. We want to eat. Yes, so. We want food to eat. Yes, we go out. But in the midst of our looking for this money, let us remember, these children that we are struggling for, if they don't turn out well, our money becomes worth. What does our money become? Worthless. Absolutely. It doesn't mean anything to us because they will bring us pain in our old age. Praise the Lord.
Let's put our hands together for the Lord. Sister Ruth, God bless you.
The Lord will increase you in wisdom and in the knowledge of him in Jesus' name. I'm just trying to round up. Somebody was asking, where did you get your own child? Did you ask for your child from God? Or did you get your child through another means? That is a food for thought. Any child that you received from the river or from wherever, and you are born again, and you are not doing anything about it, you can be sure that the owner of the child will always come back to claim his rights. Let's do things right. God will help us in Jesus' name. Now, another way is that from all that they have said, what will make a child, a 12-year-old child, believe that he can engage in suicide bombing? That means that that child had been indoctrinated in that religion so much that she or he believes so much in it. We are Christians. We have superior power. What are we doing in training up our children? The Bible says when we train them up in a particular way, they will go, when they go grow up, doing the same thing. We must teach our children value early in life. And that means that we ourselves, we must have value. Mothers, in the name of a blouse, will come to church. The breasts almost coming out. Why are we doing that? We must learn to have value so that our children also will have value. In that clip that we watched, the man was asking for the phone from the child. That may not be the solution. But the solution may be that you don't give your children all these expensive phones, all these smartphones, all these kind of phones that they can easily connect to internet without your knowledge. Try it and let's see how far it can go. Now, even during our normal services, we find children in the main church. We spend so much money on lessons, so that our children can pass school site, so that they can go to very good secondary school, so that they can go to good universities. But how much time do we devote to our children learning the word of God? We keep them here. Our house helps. We keep them in the adult church. At the end of the day, you will say that your house help is a witch. Why will she not be a witch when she doesn't have the word of God in her? Why will a child not be wayward when he is not trained up with the word of God early? There is opportunity in the children's church. And when people go around to take your children from you, you complain. It is in your own interest that your children are taught of the Lord so that their peace can be great. Can I hear amen to that? And finally, we send our children to boarding houses. Some send their children abroad. But one thing that I want to advise, be sure of the boarding houses that your children are going. Take time to find out. Even if they claim to be Christian boarding house, go and find out. Because somebody has said that it was in the boarding house that he learned drugs. Secondary school. Boarding house that he learned about alcohol. I also was in a boarding school. I know some of my mates that we jump the fence at night. I went to Christian school and they will jump the fence at night and go to parties even at that time. And of course, I saw some of them. They grew up exactly like that. But parents will never know. You take your children to abroad. But you don't have the money to be visiting with them. That is dangerous also. We must know that wherever you put your child, either in the secondary school or in the university, you must take time to go visiting. How many parents have come before me in school? Fathers will be crying because all of a sudden, they just discovered that their children have been asked to withdraw. They were not following up. They were shocked. Just 2 weeks ago, a father, a pastor, he was weeping Why? Because the son joined cult activity, and it was in the process of initiation that he became mad. So all these things are happening in our midst. It must not be found in our lives as Christians. We must play our role. I pray that the Almighty God will give us the grace for ourselves to be taught of Him, so that grace can also be the peace of our families in the name of Jesus. Let somebody shout hallelujah.
At this point, I want to just crown everything up. Our mothers and fathers have spoken very well. One of our mommies said something here, and it struck me. She said, only godly parents raise godly children. Only godly parents raise godly children. You're a parent in the house, or you're a youth like myself. Peradventure, you're a teenager, you're also here. You've never given your life to Jesus Christ before. I will not lie to you. The oil flows from the head. If you're a parent and the oil that is flowing from you is a polluted one, it's a law of nature, it's a spiritual law. It will flow to your children. You've never received Jesus as your Lord and Savior, or you know you are just coming to church, you don't have a personal relationship with Him. This is not the time to care about what anybody is thinking. We're talking about your future here. Your future here on earth, which are our children, and your future in eternity. Why not come and we'll pray together? We'll believe God together. The same God who turned my life around from somebody who was carrying gun to somebody who is carrying the Bible, that same God can touch your life. Please come and join me. Please come. You're a father, you're a mother, come and join me. You're a youth in the house, you're a teenager, you are in the cult. You smoke Indo, you smoke all sorts, you drink all sorts. Come and join me in front. Come, church, let's clap for them. Come and join me in front. Come and join me. You're a father, you're a mother. You don't want your children to end the way we've seen. God bless you, my beloved sister. God bless you, my beloved. God bless you, my sister. God bless you. Please come. 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 There's room for you at the cross. There's room for you at the cross. It's not about going to church. It's not about paying your tithes and giving offerings. It's about knowing the Lord. You are still there. I have 2 minutes more. 2 minutes more. Less than 2 minutes. You want to join me? You want to pray for your children? You want your children to turn out well? Please come. Come. I know I have some youth in the house like myself. You are into all sorts. You smoke all sorts. You drink all sorts. You might have even been initiated. Let me tell you this. I've seen occultists become pastors. Why? Because they gave their lives to Jesus Christ. And I've also seen those who spawned the gospel. They had their heads split open. Some had bullets pumped in their chest. You don't have to end that way. Please come. Come. I'm waiting. Jesus is waiting. God bless you, my young friend. God bless you. I see you gentlemen coming down. God bless you. Come. 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 I have less than 30 seconds. Please come. Those who have come, be talking to the Lord. Say, have mercy on me. Change my life. Turn my life around. I want my life to be like that of Jesus. Come. God bless you, my gentle friend. God bless you, my young man. God bless you. You will never regret this decision. I bet you, you will never regret. 1996, I made the decision. God bless you, my beloved friend. Come. 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 Even why? Fine boys and fine girls love Jesus. Fine boys and fine girls love Jesus. It's those days they used to say, it's the ugly ones that come to Jesus. You would agree with me that wise men and wise women love Jesus. Church, can we rise on our feet as we pray for these ones? Everyone in front, begin to talk to God. Father, have mercy on me. Give me a new heart. Talk to Him. Talk to Him. You said if anyone comes to you, you will not cast away. Father, I've come to you today. I believe you will not cast me away. Make me your son. Make me your daughter. write my name in the book of life. Almighty God, turn my life around. Deliver me from myself. Deliver me from the devil. Deliver me from sin. Deliver me, oh God. I don't want to turn out like my father and mother. I want to be a better person. I want my life to count now and in eternity. Talk to God. Talk to God. Church, can we pray for them? That these ones will not never go back to their vomit. That their lives will be glorious. That God will show them mercy. That they will be grafted into Christ. That these ones, their lifestyle will change by the power of the Holy Ghost. Father, we thank you. We bless your name. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. I want to pray for you. And after I pray for you, there's a gentleman there with a sign reading counseling. Counselors, you will follow them after I pray for you. Father, I pray for these your sons and daughters, that you will save them radically in the name of Jesus Christ. You are no respecter of any man. These ones, they fear you. That's why they came. Father, put your hand of power upon them and give them a new heart in the name of Jesus. Every habit they are struggling with that is bringing their lives down, Father, by your power, deliver them in the name of Jesus Christ. Make it impossible for them to go back to their vomit in the name of Jesus Christ. Whoever you have not planted in their lives that is polluting their destiny, by the sword of your spirit, we sever them from such in the name of Jesus. Every ungodly appetite in them for bad things, we decree they die in Jesus' name. Give them appetite for righteous things. Father, may these ones, may they abide to the coming of Jesus Christ. May they bring forth fruit even to 100-fold. I pray for every family here. I pray that the Almighty God will show our homes mercy. I pray that the grace to live as worthy parents, to live as good examples, God will give every parent here in the name of Jesus. I pray for all the children that no matter how your parents live, the grace to live like Jesus, receive in the name of Jesus. For those who are still struggling with one habit or the other, the same God who delivered me, that same God is rich unto you. Receive your deliverance now in the name of Jesus. Father, we bless you. We give you all the glory and praise. In Jesus' majestic name, we pray. Church, can we appreciate the Lord for them, please?